us together. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory. Please turn to page 277, and as we sing verse 2, let's welcome one another to God's house. Have you had the victory this week?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And now you can have joy unspeakable. Because of that victory we have each day, we have the joy of God in our lives. Page 277.
All complete, he supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free as free indeed. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and full of glory. All I have has never yet been told.
So wonderful to be here this morning, and so good to see each and every one of you. We're blessed and we're thankful to have some guests this morning. Thank you for coming. We're glad that you could be here and share time with us. And I see another brother back there. The last time I seen him, He was sitting over near the state line in a nursing home. Brother, it's so good to have you this morning. I'm thankful that you can make it. So thankful you could be here today. Praise the Lord. That's a dramatic improvement over what we've seen before. He was pretty weak a couple of weeks ago. But Brother Revy is here today, and we're thankful for it. And thankful for our other guests that have shown up, each and every one of you. And just pray that you have a wonderful time of worship today, and that you will experience God's presence. Amen. That's what we're here for, to worship Him, to glorify Him, to lift Him up, and to experience that sweet, sweet presence of God in our lives and in our time of fellowship. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to come before you, to worship, to pray, to lift up your name, and to give you praise and honor and glory, Father, for all that you've done. We thank you, Lord, that you have kept us through this week, that you have set aside this day for us, Father, that we might rest and turn our thoughts and our minds towards you. Father, we just pray that you would help each and every one of us to totally put our meditations and our thoughts and our hearts upon the worship of Almighty God. We pray, Father, that you would be with us here today, that you would bless in all that's said and done, that you would talk to each and every one of us in a personal way, Father, that you would help us to grow in our faith and to grow, Lord, in you and in your word. And Father, I pray that you would speak to hearts, that you would open our minds, and that you would visit us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Psalm 150, praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for the surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and lyre. Praise him with tambourine and dancing. Praise him with the strings of a flute. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with the resounding of cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Aaliyah. I think it's a wonderful thing to hear a little child read the Word of God. I couldn't help but tear up as she was reading. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
He truly makes all things possible. Amen. If he can turn my life around, all things are possible. I believe that fully 100%. With Jesus Christ, all things are possible. And outside of him, you can't get much done on your own. You're going to make a mess, I'll guarantee you. Your life will head down the wrong path and end in an eternity of awful suffering. But with him, he makes all things possible. We'd like to go to prayer this morning on that thought. It's so wonderful to be able to take our burdens before him, our cares, our pains, our sufferings, our troubles, whatever it is, take them to him and lay them at his feet and then leave them there. Not to pick them up again and tote them around by ourselves, but to leave them at his feet and submit ourselves to his answers. But if you have prayer requests this morning, we'd like to take those at this time. And I would like to request prayer for my youngest daughter. She's got pink eye in both eyes, not both ears. That would be awful, pink eye in your ears. She has pink eye in both eyes, so remember her in prayer. Do we have other outspoken requests? Sister Donna? We have several announcements. We have a nursing home service today at River Ridge at 2:30. So anyone who can come out and join us there for that, it would be a blessing to you. You want to be blessed? All you have to do is serve other people around you. You'll be blessed every time. And these nursing home services have been a blessing to me. They've been an encouragement to me. Now, I know you're looking at me, how can going to a nursing home be an encouragement to you? By God's divine providence, that's how. Because otherwise, it wouldn't be a blessing to me. But it is a blessing. God does bless. God does move and work on your heart while you're there worshiping with those folks who maybe are not able to get up or do for themselves anymore. We have a 6 o'clock service this evening. We would love for each and every one of you to come out. And we have youth TNT this evening at 6 o'clock. So all the youth that can make it, please come out and join them. I'm sure you will have a great time. We have a Wednesday evening service at 7. And then on Thursday night at 7 o'clock, we have a special guest. His name is Usama Dakdak. Yes, that is an odd name. He was born in Egypt to Baptist missionaries, and he grew up in Egypt, went to Islamic schools. He knows a lot about Islam, and he has so much information about how that religion is slowly creeping its way into American society in every facet. Whether it be education, the government, you name it, that thing is slowly just like little tentacles. Wherever it finds a loose spot, it works itself in and then starts to open that spot up. So he's going to share with us a lot of information about that Thursday evening at 7 o'clock. The great thing about it is I don't think you'll leave here with some kind of dread or fear, but you will leave here informed. And you will leave here with some tools, some information that will help you to reach out to Muslim people. Now, I don't know about you, but most of us are a little uncomfortable engaging with somebody who's wearing a burqa over their head, right? We're a little bit uncomfortable. I'd say at least 98%, 99% of us, and I'd be one of those. But they're people. They're souls. They are in a system that is bondage. And they need deliverance, just like any other sinner. So let's remember that service in prayer especially. And if you can come out this Thursday to join us at 7 o'clock, I'll guarantee you, will not regret it. We'd like to take our morning offering at this time, if there's no other announcements. I didn't miss any announcements, correct? just making sure. Usually somebody's got another announcement they want me to announce. Brother Jack, would you lead us in prayer?
Father, we thank you for your goodness to us in this good day. Forgiveness, Lord, we thank you for the pastor that we have, Lord, and we pray that you bless him, Father, as he brings the word to us, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you just bless those that are giving for you, Father. We pray that you just bless each one. We just give you praise. Amen.
Keep me safe till the storm passes by, right there in the hollow of your hand. There is an announcement, Pastor David. Peggy would like you to start saving 2-liter bottles, pop bottles. They will be using them for a Bible school project, I think. So start saving your 2-liter pop bottles. She'll have a box for them tonight. And then also I want to thank God for being with us this past week, especially with Brad Wednesday, as he had this accident. Happened about 10:30 in the morning. They were very busy in their operating rooms, and they didn't get him in until quite late. But God has a purpose for everything. Wondered, should we leave Lakeland and St. Joe and take him to South Bend to the orthopedic hospital down there? What should we do? So Nikki went to make some phone calls, and Gerald and I had prayer with Brad, and we just prayed that God would give him the best doctor wherever it was supposed to be. If Nikki could get the contacts made at South Bend Orthopedics, take him there. If not, there at Lakeland, whatever. Well, the doctor came in between 3:30 and 4, and he said, it's still going to be a while before we can get you in, but he said, I'm going to South Bend to pick up a colleague. This man is... The doctor himself is a plastic surgeon and also a hand specialist, and the man he was going to pick up was a hand specialist as well. And he said, he's going to be looking over my shoulder right there in the operating room, and we're going to do the best that we can. He said, with your type of work, we know that you need as much of your fingers as possible. So I guess I didn't tell you the first part of the story. He got tips of his fingers cut off in an accident at work. So anyway, we feel that God had his way. He had the best doctors. He's recovering as best as you can in that kind of a situation. But we just thank God for answering prayer. We just felt a peace about the whole thing, that he had the best. Isn't that what God does? He gives us the best. So keep him in your prayers and just lift him up, because Brad is, he loves the Lord, and he just wants to give God glory through all of this. Now turn in your hymnals to page 326. I'll follow with rejoicing. Sometimes that's a little hard to do, isn't it? But even though many times things come upon us in life, we don't feel like rejoicing, we can still have the joy of the Lord in our hearts. Things come, but things also pass. It's how we deal with them during those times. I'll follow with rejoicing.
Love.
turn in your chorus books to page number 85. These brown books there in the song racks. Page number 85. There's something about that name. When you think about that name of Jesus, doesn't it quiet the heart? You can be in the middle of something just horrific, but Jesus, just the mention of his name, quiets the heart. There's no other name that can do that. I could call my husband's name, my children's names, but it's not the same. Jesus, Master, Savior. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, and they have. They've risen and they've fallen. But the name of Jesus is always the same. Yes. There's power, there's comfort, and there's peace in the name of Jesus. Sing it again.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, Jesus.
You're dismissed for Children's Church. Pastor David.
What a wonderful name, the name of Jesus. You want to know why the name is so wonderful? There's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. Amen. That's why that name is so precious. There's no salvation in Muhammad. There's no salvation in Buddha. There's no salvation in any other name but the name of Jesus Christ. That's why it's so refreshing to the soul. That's why it's so soothing to the spirit. That's why it's so calming and peaceful to the human heart. Because there's no other access to God. Every human heart, whether they want to admit to it or not, knows that there's a God, that there's a greater being. But the only access to Him, the only peace with Him, the only way we can have relationships with Him is through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. What a wonderful song. We could sing that for another half an hour. I wouldn't get tired of it. Amen. If you would, let's turn in your Bibles this morning to Matthew chapter 19. A very familiar passage of Scripture about the rich young ruler. There are so many different facets to this story. We could probably do, who knows how many messages could be preached from this particular passage of Scripture, and who knows how many messages have already been preached from this particular passage. I've preached from it several times myself, but every time that I read it and study it and look into it, I always discover more. That's the wonderful thing about the Word of God. You can open a passage that you've read hundreds of times before, and God will speak to you again, speak His words of life through His living Word to you. What a wonderful thing. Matthew chapter 19, and we want to start in verse 16. And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? And he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments. And he saith unto him, Which? Jesus said, Thou shalt do no murder, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And the young man saith unto him, All these things have I kept from my youth up, what lack I yet? And Jesus said unto him, If thou wilt be perfect, go and sell that thou hast, and give it to the poor. And thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And we'll stop right there. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you have left it for us, Father, as a guide and a rule for our life. We pray, Lord, that you would speak to each and every heart through your word this morning. Pray, Lord, for myself, that you would anoint me, that you would give me, Lord, the words that you would have spoken today, and that you would keep from my lips anything, Lord, that would not be of you, that would not be of your Son. Father, we pray for those who are not here this morning. We see some faces that have not with us this morning. We don't know the circumstances. We just pray for those folks, Lord, that you would minister to them wherever they are and touch their hearts. But we are here, Lord, and we pray that you would speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. The parable of the rich young ruler. You know, as I read this passage of Scripture again and was studying on it, I thought, how many rich young rulers do we have today in the society that we live in? We are all pretty wealthy. You know, it's none of us are extremely poor. Most of us have a roof over our head. We have food on our table. We have clothes on our back. I don't see anyone in here this morning wearing rags. So we can all fall into, in some way, shape, or form, this category of the rich young ruler. And it was not the fact that he was rich or the fact that he was poor. It was what he was after. That's where the problem lies with us. In our modern day culture, in our modern day context, that is when we think about God, when we think about salvation, when we think about spiritual attainment or things that we want to pursue spiritually, we all run into the same thing that the rich young ruler had. The first thing that caught my attention as I was reading this passage, he says, What shall I do that I may have eternal life? And that word have really stood out to me. Because this rich young ruler's mentality was, Jesus, what can I do to get this eternal life? And then it's mine. I can put it in my back pocket. I can go on and do whatever I want to do. And I've got this insurance policy in my back pocket. How many in America today? How many are sitting in churches this morning have that same mentality? They want a spiritual insurance policy. And that's all they want. They want Sunday morning, Sunday evening, maybe Wednesday night to be devoted to the Lord. But they want this area over here of their life that's still mine. That I can do what I want. That this space is mine. I can wall this off from God. That's not how God works. Amen.
God wants all of you. It's not the fact that the rich young ruler was rich. God didn't need his riches. God bestowed his riches upon him. The problem was that he wanted to have this insurance policy. A spiritual insurance policy that he could stick in his back pocket and say, I got the goods. I'm going to come worship God today. I'm going to go do some good deeds. I'm going to work on this project. I'm going to work on that project. I'm going to do this for the Lord. But now, I've done that. I'm going to go spend some time with me. It doesn't work that way, my friend. It doesn't work that way. God wants to live within you. He wants to control you. He wants to put His Holy Spirit within your life. He wants to knock down walls within your life. He wants to do a remodeling project in your heart. Amen. He wants to live. He wants to motivate you. He wants to control you. He wants to send you where He needs you. He wants to speak through you when He needs to speak through you. That may be down at the ballpark, it may be at Walmart, it may be in your backyard with your neighbor. I don't know where, but there is no place where it's your territory. And God's is over there. There's none. You don't have any life left. You don't have, if you come to salvation in Jesus Christ, you don't have anything left that you can say, this is my area. It's all His. The rich young ruler wanted to know, what can I do? What can I do to have it, to possess it? What can I do to make it mine? He did not understand the nature of eternal life. He asked for eternal life. He was desiring a good thing, but he didn't understand the nature of eternal life. Eternal life is not something that you can go and possess and have. Eternal life is something that you live and motivates you and moves through you. It is a way of being. That's why the Bible tells us, be you transformed by the renewing of your mind. It's a transformation process. It is not a purchase. You cannot contract eternal life with God. He comes and puts His eternal life within you. He puts His Spirit within you and causes it to motivate you and move you and direct you. Amen. And we try to wall off those sections. Okay, I've served God. I've done this. And I worry. You know, we're working on the youth center right now. And I pray that that youth center is used for the glory of God. But if we're not careful, ladies, gentlemen, everybody that's worked on it, that work will become the goal. If we're not careful, we'll turn it into we're working for God. Okay, now we're done working for God. We're going to go do what we want to do. Let me tell you, that is a very deceptive thing. And it's a thing that can get a hold of me and get a hold of you, each and every one of you. And they're not just the youth center, but everything that we do. Be careful when you say, I'm going to go do this for God today. No, when you get up and you start breathing and thinking in the morning, you are doing that for God. When you get up and you look at that old face in the mirror and you say, man, that hair is dirty, and you start cleaning it up and you wash that old face, you're doing it for God. When you go in the kitchen and you start washing dishes, you're doing it for God. Every aspect of your life should be with Him in mind and Him leading and directing you. The rich young ruler didn't want that. Most people today don't want that. They want a spiritual insurance policy. They want reassurance that I'm going to go to heaven. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father. No man getteth into heaven. No man reaches that spiritual eternal life except through Jesus Christ. And I don't mean an experience of believing in Him. I mean an experience of Him filling you and motivating you and moving you. That's religion. What did James say about religion? Pure religion and undefiled before God is to visit the widow and the fatherless in their affliction. And to keep yourself... I love Church of God. What was that? Unspotted from the world. Praise the Lord. That's pure religion. There's no places. There's no little boxes that you can say, okay, this is my territory. This is my time. It's all God's time. Amen. He saved you. He redeemed you. You've become, in essence, His slave. his servant. But I'm so thankful this morning that it's not that slave servant. See, that's what the young man who was down in the hog pen, he went back, he said, I'm just going to be a slave to my father. At least they've got food to eat. At least they've got things prepared for them. But what happened? When he went back, the father said, Oh, no, you're my son. Come on in. Isn't that a wonderful thing? If you're here this morning and you don't know God, this experience that I'm talking about is not going to be a laborsome thing. But you're going to be welcome into the family of God. Amen. Like one of his children. He's going to put his arms around you. He's going to fill your life. He's going to bless you. He's going to work on you. There might be some remodeling projects that need to take place in your life. There's some walls that need to be tore down. There's some habits that need to be kicked. There's some things that need to be transformed in your life. But you are his son. You are his daughter. And he loves you. And he wants to perfect you. See, it's not about you trying to make yourself better. God himself wants to perfect you. He wants to make you into his image. He wants to make you a witness and a testimony, a living epistle for him. He wants to place himself within your heart because he loves you. He loves you. He loves his son. He gave his son that he might transform our lives, that he might send us out into the world and impact others. How? Through your abilities? No. Through the Holy Spirit living Amen. In you. Being an example to the world around you. What kind of example are we showing this morning, folks? Do you got little areas that are yours? We know that was the rich young ruler's heart. By verse 18, he asked a question. Jesus said, "Why?" In the preceding verse, Jesus said, "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments." And he said, which? See, he wasn't motivated by a love, a heart for God, seeking after God. He was motivated by the goal. Jesus said in the verse before that, if thou wilt enter into life, not that I'm going to give it to you, but that you want to enter into life, here's the way that you do it. Keep the commandments. He was addressing the heart problem. He was addressing the rich young ruler's heart and the areas that he wanted to keep for himself, the things that he wanted to maintain. And so the rich young ruler said, which commandments? Now, somebody that really wanted to know God would have taken that, the commandments, okay, I'm going to go and love God with all my heart. I'm going to seek after those commandments. I'm going to try to fulfill them with all my heart and with all my desire. But Jesus already knew his heart. And the rich young ruler said, which one? He wanted a purchase. He wanted a contract. If I do this, then I get this. Isn't that the human mentality? Isn't that what each and every one of us expect in some kind of way? If I do this, then I want this. If I do this, I get this. That's the way we conduct our lives on a day-to-day basis. I mean, that's how we go to work and we earn our salaries. If I go in, I put my time in, I get paid a certain amount. If I do this, then I get this. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. My kingdom is not of this world. My kingdom doesn't operate in this fashion. My kingdom doesn't do and act in these kind of ways. My kingdom is a kingdom of love. Amen. Love that's mutual. It flows in both directions. God loves you, and you have to have a love for God. He said, if you love me and keep my commandments, I'll come unto you. Jesus said, if you love me and you keep my commandments, my Father and I will come unto you and we will make our abode with you. What a wonderful thing. But it takes us submitting and surrendering ourselves. Rich young ruler, coming on down, he asked the question, which? And that question reveals his heart. We want to know, how much does God require? I'll guarantee you this morning, there are people sitting in this audience, in this little small gathering of people, wondering, how much do I have to do to gain eternal life? How much do I have to do? They want to know, what does God require? How much? We try to discover the minimum that's required to satisfy God. That's what the rich young ruler was trying to do. He was trying to decide. He was trying to get a clear answer about what is the minimum that I have to do to guarantee me this eternal life thing that he's talking about. The reason that he wanted to discover the minimum was so that he could reserve the rest to himself. How many of us are living in that reality? We want to know the minimum of what we have to do to God so that we can reserve the rest for ourselves. That's dangerous ground, my friend. That's dangerous ground. It's kind of like paying taxes. Most people got, when they talk about spiritual things, they got the same mentality as paying taxes. What do we try to do when we pay taxes? We want to meet the minimum requirement, right? Nobody wants to pay any more than they have to. The kingdom of God is not of this world. The kingdom of God, the requirements are different. It's not a transaction, it's not a contract, but it's a total submission of your will to the will of God. Saying, God, whatever it is, it's all yours. My life, my talent, my all. Everything that I have, every ability that I might have, it's yours, Lord. Every step that I take, Lord, it's yours. When I get in that old vehicle, Lord, it's yours. When you take me down the road, it's yours, Lord. When I meet somebody in the parking lot, it's your time, Father. Help me to be your witness. Give me the words to speak. When I'm at the ballpark, it's your time, Lord. I'm there for you. I'm representing you. When I come to church on Sunday morning, I'm there for you, Lord. Not for me. Not that I might enjoy it, but that I might learn something of you. And that I might give my time, give my talents, give whatever I have to offer in service to you, in service to everyone else. Serving God is about serving others. That's what the verses in James are telling us. Serving God is all about serving others. Keep yourself pure and undefiled from the world in serving others. Jesus says in chapter 22, verse 37, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. That's the commandment. We must be careful of becoming like the Pharisees, who were consumed with the worship service, but forgot who was being worshiped. Right here in Coulter's Chapel, we have to be careful that we don't turn Sunday morning service and whatever service we do in relation to this congregation, that we don't turn that into what's being worshiped. It's careful to do. It becomes routine. It becomes mundane. It's just something I do. The Pharisees, they had worship. They were faithful in their worship. But what were they worshiping? They were worshiping the service. They were worshiping the activity. They were not worshiping the living God. And that mentality can still invade us today in our lives. We must be careful of what we worship and how we worship. Jesus also said in Matthew 23 and verse 5, but all their works they do to be seen of men. And it's easy for us to fall into this same trap. It's easy for us to show up here on Sunday morning just to be seen of men, just to hold up that picture that everything's all right with me spiritually, what are you doing? You've turned the worship of God into just the worship of a service. We need to be careful that we prepare our hearts, that we prepare our minds. Before we get here, we place our thoughts upon Him. We place our meditations upon Him, upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Because we can get consumed with just showing up, just doing the routine, just doing the things for God. Oh, I'm working for God. No, you're not. You're putting a picture up for everybody else to think you're in good shape with God. That happens. I've seen it happen in churches before, where religious activity becomes the worship, becomes the goal. Religious activity does not necessarily lead to a greater experience. We need that experience that's spoken of in James, where our religion and our worship is not a talking religion or a talking worship, but it's a walking worship. You need a walking relationship with God. You need a moving, a growing, a developing, a continual efforting for the things of God and in His Word, not just talking it, not just parroting it. That's easy to do. But God looks on the heart. This activity is spoken of in James chapter 1, verse 27, of visiting the fatherless, visiting the orphans, is not the totality of the religious experience. None of these things separate of themselves. Your religious experience should be more than just coming to church. But on the other hand, your religious experience should be more than just visiting the fatherless and the widows. Your religion should be more than just praying. Your religion should be more than any one of these things that you can set aside and say, oh, I do this or I do that. A relationship with God is all those things pulled together. They all have a vital part in our lives. You can pray yourself silly, and if you don't have fellowship and you don't have outreach to other folks and people who are hurting, you're not fulfilling the Word of God. Mere prayer or more prayer does not necessarily mean more spirituality. I know that's a shocking statement to you this morning, isn't it? More prayer does not equal more spirituality. More fervent prayer does not equal more spirituality. Some of the most powerful prayers that are in the Bible were very, very short prayers. If you don't believe me, just look at what Elijah prayed. Amen. We could go on down the list of people who prayed very short prayers that God moved. Why? Because their heart was right. Their life was right. Everything else was in alignment. When everything else is in alignment, you are constantly communing with God. You don't have to set aside a certain part of the day to talk to God. You talk to Him all the time. Amen. It's a thing He's living within you. He is speaking to you minute by minute, moment by moment, directing and leading your life. Now, I do think prayer time is necessary. We all need prayer, but it's not the end all and be all. And we all need to do some kind of work for the Lord, but it's not the end all and be all of your experience, folks. We need the comprehensive approach. Prayer is necessary. Prayer is good. But just because you meet a prayer regiment or requirement will not absolutely bring you closer to God. But you want to know what will bring you closer to God? Submitting your will. Submitting your will, your wants, desires, your attitudes, your habits, everything about you, you submit it to God. That'll bring you closer to Him. That'll draw you deeper with Him. That'll bring you to a greater experience of God's power in your life, moment by moment, walking with Him. Total surrender of all that you are to the will of God. The psalmist captured it perfectly in Psalms chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Day and night. Constantly meditating upon the things of God, allowing the Word of God to soak down into your soul and motivate you and move you in ways that would be pleasing to God. Did you notice he covered every aspect of human activity in that verse? He said, blessed is the man that walketh not. In other words, watch your steps. Watch where you're moving. Watch where you're walking. Watch what you're doing. Then what did he say? Nor sitteth in the way of sinners. There's another activity. Sitting. Nor standing in the way of sinners. Whether you're walking, sitting, or standing, place your thoughts, place your heart upon the worship of God, upon the communication with God and what He has for you in your life. The psalmist also captured it in chapter 19, verse 14, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. He's your redeemer. He purchased you. If you're saved this morning, He purchased you. If you're unsaved this morning, His blood is extended, waiting to make that purchase. Amen. You have nothing to bring to the transaction. Only thing you have is your will that you can pour out at His feet, that you can throw at the feet of Jesus and say, Lord, I surrender all that I am. You don't have anything else to offer. There's no other thing that you can do to have this eternal life. This eternal life doesn't start when you die. It starts when you get saved. It starts when you surrender and submit yourself to the Word of God and to the blood of Jesus Christ. That's when it starts. I'm so glad that I have a piece of eternal life this morning. I'm so thankful that I made that decision and the Lord saved me. We sing that old song, the Lord save me, the Lord save me. Amen. He did it. I didn't. The only thing I did is said, Lord, I can't do it anymore. I give up. I give up. I've tried. I've tried to discover happiness. I've tried to find something that would make me complete. I've tried to find something that would give me peace. I can't find it, Lord. But I found it, Lord, in Thee. An everlasting store. Praise God that there's an everlasting store. It will never run out. There is peace to fill all your needs. There is grace to fill all your deficiencies. Amen. No matter who you are and what you've been through and what you've done, there's grace that will pour out and cover it and make you right in the sight of God. And that grace is the blood of Jesus Christ, which cleanses us from all sin. Thank the Lord for that this morning. Thankful for what He's done. God is looking for everything. The rich young ruler said, what thing? God's reply is everything. Ananias and Sapphira found that out the hard way. God didn't require of them everything. But they came and put on the front that, we're given everything. And the Holy Spirit struck them dead. God still hates these little front offerings. He hates these pretending of submitting yourself. He's looking for hearts that are willing to fully submit themselves and fully submerge themselves in His Word. God says He wants to move in. He wants to take over. The rich young ruler said, what may I do that I may have? He wanted to possess eternal life. You don't possess eternal life. Eternal life possesses you. The Holy Spirit moves in and does His work. In verse 20 of this passage in Matthew chapter 19, it reads, "The young man saith unto him, All these things have I kept from my youth up. What lack I yet?" All these things. Did you notice? Jesus said, if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments. Then he goes through the list of commandments. And then the young man says, all these things have I kept from my youth up. Therefore, in his eyes, he had already filled the requirements, correct? He had lots of credentials. I just wonder here today who's got lots of credentials. Who thinks they've done a lot of good works? Who thinks they've lived a pretty good life? They've tried to keep to the best of their ability the things of God. Are you still lacking something? That's what the young man said. He said, what lack I yet? I've fulfilled all those. I've signed the contract on those parts, Lord. What is it yet? What other part do I need to sign? What can I do? When he found out what he could do, boy, it was a bitter gall to him. It was a bitter gall. He went away sorrowful when he found out that it required all of him. You know what? If his heart hadn't have been in that condition, Christ wouldn't have told him, just give it away all. But those things were interfering with him surrendering and submitting himself to God. What's keeping you from submitting yourself to God? What relationship is it? What possession is it? What's keeping us from fully saying, Lord, thy will be done? Have you ever had to humble yourself before a person? That's a terrible thing to the human. I see those people, you know, those kings and queens over there in Europe, and these people bowing down before them. I don't know. There's something about me. I guess my ancestors were ones that rejected all that and come over here. But there's something about me that does not want to bow down and submit myself before another person. Even when we have foot washing service, you'll find that it's not the natural instinct, it's not the natural human mindset to kneel down before someone and wash their feet. Am I right? Amen. It's not a natural thing. But it's the grace of God that moves in you and gives you what you need to do that. The rich young ruler said, what lack I yet? The devil loves finding people who are seeking something more. One more thing that they need to do. One more requirement that they need to fulfill. He will keep you running in circles, trying to meet that one more requirement to reach heaven. He loves finding those who are seeking something more. He has lots to offer. He has very attractive things. He has experiences. He has theories that might seem like the answer. Oh, now you've got it. You can never possess it, but you must let it possess you. Jesus said in verse 21 at the end of this passage, come and follow me. There lies the key to eternal life. You want eternal life? You want to know you're on the way to heaven? Follow Jesus. Amen. You want to know that your experience is real? Keep His commandments. Follow the Lord. You don't get it and then go your own way, but you forsake your way. You throw down everything that's yours. You throw down everything that you've held on. You take away all those areas that once were yours and say, Lord, I'm going to follow you. I'm going to give it all to you. When you do that, praise God, you can experience eternal life. You can experience it right now, today, this morning, by submitting all your will. And when you do that, you will find rest to your soul. You will find peace like you've never experienced before. You will find contentment. Jesus said in Matthew 11, verses 28 and 29, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." The devil wants to keep you running in circles trying to fulfill that last requirement. He'll even trick you into thinking that you've fulfilled the last requirement. You're guaranteed a spot in heaven now. Praise the Lord. He's got a lot of people living in that confusion. You have made it. You're there. No need to worry about anything else. But Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me." This is the following part that he told the rich young ruler. Take my yoke upon you. In other words, take the life of Jesus upon you and follow me, or learn of me. For I am meek and lowly of heart. And when you get down that path, when you start the path of walking with Jesus, you shall find rest to your soul. You shall find what your heart desires. You will find everything that you need for life. You will find that yoke, that life that Jesus led is not a heavy life. It's not a hard life. He said, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light." Have we given up all this morning? Have you surrendered every facet of your life to Him? Is there some other area that you've got reserved for you, that you're holding on to, clinging to? I just ask the questions. I can't answer. Each one of you know your heart. You know what you've reserved for yourself and what you've surrendered to God. But the requirement of Jesus Christ is surrender all. See, the Holy Spirit doesn't cohabitate. Holy Spirit will not live in a vessel that's not His. It's either His or He's going to move on. He wants it all. He wants full title. He wants deed. He wants the whole thing. That's the only way He can remake us and reshape us, is when He has the deed. He has the title. Because otherwise we've got areas, no, hold on, you can't. Can't mess with that. Can't touch that. A lot of people are there at that place where God can't touch one area of my life. I'll live for Him on Sunday morning. I'll go to church on Sunday evening. I'll go Sunday night. Wednesday night. I'll work. I'll do this. But this is my time here. You know, God's got lots of fun things for you to do. And you can experience them all with Him. Every one of them. And they'll be richer, they'll be sweeter, they'll be more real, they'll be more full than you've ever experienced before when you do it with God. And God moving you and motivating you. But when you say, "God, I did your work, you stay over there, I'm going to go do this." It doesn't work that way. He vacates homes that are not His. He wants the whole heart of each and every one of us. I leave the thoughts with you this morning. If you haven't surrendered your heart, now would be a great time to do it. Jesus stands waiting for each and every one who will come unto Him and follow Him. Take that yoke upon Him, upon yourself. He extends grace. He extends mercy. He extends love. We're still alive today. We're still in this time of grace. It's still ready. He's still waiting. He's still extending it this morning. "Come unto me, all you who are weary, and you shall find rest. You shall find peace. You shall find eternal life." I enjoy my eternal life. I enjoy being moved by the Spirit of God. I enjoy seeing what He does and how He uses me and folks around me, how He blesses other people's lives through my life, through my existence. But He can't use us until we surrender and submit. He wants you this morning. The opportunity of grace goes out one more time, even now. Sisters, if you would come and prepare a song for us. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for your Spirit that speaks to us and moves us. Father, I just pray this morning that you would have your way. Lord, speak to those who maybe don't know you. Father, speak to those who have areas of their life that are not surrendered and submitted to you. Help us, Lord, not to be looking for that insurance policy of salvation, but help us, Lord, to surrender ourselves that that salvation and that eternal life might take a hold of us in a way that we've never experienced before. God, I pray that you would keep us and help us, Lord, not to be double-minded in our life. Your word tells us that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Father, I just cry out that you would help me and any others, Lord, who struggle with this area of their life. Father, we see the necessity of submitting ourselves to your purpose and to your will. God, I just pray if there's some here this morning who have not done that, that they would lay themselves at the feet of Jesus and say, I give up trying to find it on my own, Lord, but I need you. I need your grace. I need to submit myself to you. We thank you, Lord, for all that you would do and all that you will accomplish. In Jesus' name.
Page 157, 157. Would you stand, please?
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. All to Jesus surrender, make me Savior. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that Thou art mine. I surrender all. I surrender. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Have we surrendered all this morning? All includes all your preferences. It may not be that big of a news flash to you all, but I didn't prefer to come to Michigan.
But guess what? I found peace. I found joy in doing the service of my master. I found grace. I found love poured out in abundance by this congregation. Because I give up what I preferred and followed my Lord and Savior. You want to experience peace this morning? And grace and joy? Give up your preferences. Give up your possessions. Don't go away saying David said to give everything to the church. That's not what I meant. I mean in your heart and in your mind, make that commitment. Lord, it's yours. However you want to use it. Father, I no longer have possession of it. It belongs to you. And most of all, submit your soul to him who is able to save and to keep to the uttermost. That's what he wants to do for each and every one of us. He would that none would be lost, but that all should come to repentance. See, all want to come to everlasting life, but not many want to come to repentance. It's a hard place, but it's the place of access to his grace. It's a place of submission to his will. Amen. All to Jesus I surrender.
All to Jesus I surrender. Lord, I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Thankful for your attention this morning. Pray that the message would sink into your hearts and to your minds, that you would take it with you throughout the day. This is the Lord's day. Meditate upon it. Reflect on it. Look at your life and see if it's fully surrendered and committed to God. Look for those little areas maybe where you're holding back, saying, Lord, that's mine. He'll bless you in your surrender, I'll guarantee you. Remember our service this evening as we depart from here, and the nursing home service this afternoon. And I pray that each and every one of you can make it back out tonight or next Wednesday night or Thursday night for the presentation on Islam. We would love to have you for that, and I guarantee it will be something you don't want to miss. Brother Garrell, would you close us today with prayer?
Precious Father, we come before you this morning again, Lord. We thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for the good message this morning, Lord. We pray that you would just continue to use it, Lord, and help us, Lord, to weigh it upon ourselves, Lord, and to see the, where we might fall short, Lord, in the measure to it, Lord. We pray that you would just work, be with us as we go our ways, protect, bring us back safely, Lord, and just bless and have your way. And we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.